Hey guys, what's up? My name is Speedbreaker and today I have a bit of a different video for the channel. I'm gonna be doing a build video for my first ever home server. Now initially I had planned to do a build slash how to set up Linux and how to install a couple web server related tools in one video, until I realized that building in this case, which is a Fractal Design Define Mini, is actually much more difficult than I anticipated. Just check out the amount of space that my hand has on top of the cooler here and between the top panel when I try to reach the cables back there. Yeah, silly me, try to connect these after I've actually put the motherboard in a computer. Anyways, the build was actually very adventurous, and if you're interested in how I put everything together in this rather small form factor, then definitely stick around. If you're interested in the exact parts that I chose for this build and why I'm actually building a home server at all, check out this video in the top right hand corner where I go over all of these topics. But with that being said, let's hop right into the build. So first we're obviously going to install the CPU by placing it with the small little triangle in the bottom left corner. You can see where to put it by looking at the socket cover and close the socket lever. Now when installing the RAM, we obviously want to make sure that the two sticks of the same kit are going into the same dual channel RAM slots, so there's usually a space in between. But of course, if you do have a set of four, then it doesn't really matter where to put them in. Next, let's put together the cooler. So first of all, we have this metal backplate, and we have this kind of plastic film that we put on top, and then we put the screws for the LGA 1155 socket into the middle holes. Turn it around, which will result in everything falling out once again, and put the four Intel washers on top. Next, we place the motherboard on top of the metal backplate and put the four screw nuts in. Next, we're gonna place a smudge of thermal paste on our CPU. And yeah, in this case, it was maybe a little bit too much, but to be honest, it doesn't really matter how much you put on top unless you put too few or too much. Now comes the anchoring mount, which will screw into the screw nuts. Don't forget to peel off the plastic cover from your CPU cooler and make sure not to smash it into your motherboard as I did. I also always like to clean it with some alcohol and a paper towel to make sure that it don't have any residue below the cooler. Now before we get into actually putting the cooler on top, and in retrospective I realized that I made a big mistake. Now when I put the cooler on top, silly me didn't realize that there was actually a chassis fan pin header underneath the cooler. And because I usually build in kind of big form factors with regular ATX boards, all of the fan headers would be at the border of the motherboard rather than in the middle as in this case. So if you also build in a small form factor, make sure to check if one of your fans are going to get blocked by the cooler. And in that case, you probably want to install the fans prior to installing the cooler. Next, we're gonna place the behemoth of a cooler on top of our CPU and place the mounting plate on top. We're gonna screw this into the anchoring plate via the long screwdriver that is provided in the box. Anti-vibration pads are also provided by Thermaltake in order to make sure that your CPU is as silent as possible. Now the next step is probably one of the most annoying ones in any PC assembly, and that is putting the fan on top of the air cooler. Now they usually provide these kind of fan clips that you put into the cooler and then try to kind of pry over the heatsink. But because the fins of the heatsink are actually very sharp, doing so with bare hands is maybe not recommended, and you should probably resort to using some sort of tools if you don't want to end up cutting yourself in the fingers as I did. Connect the fan to the CPU fan pin and let's move on to putting everything into our case. Now, because this home server is obviously going to be running 24/7, I'm personally very concerned in terms of the loudness of this thing. So I replace the regularly installed exhaust fan with this Silent Wings 2 fan. Also, in the front, there is only one fan installed per default, which I'm gonna upgrade with a second one that I took from the rear in order to make sure that I can run both of these fans at relatively low RPMs and to make sure that all of the hard drives that are gonna be just behind these fans have a nice cool breeze. Now, the installation process of this intake fan is actually quite weird. In fact, there is this kind of plastic holder that you can screw out of the front, and then you can kind of clip the fan into the plastic shroud and put it back into the case. As a next step, I usually like to put the PSU in, which in my case is going to be fully modular and even fanless. Note that you really want to install these PSUs with the open side facing to the top. Now also, if you're interested in the exact parts that I'm using for this home server, then check out the affiliate links in the description. Installing the hard drives is super straightforward. You have these kind of metal cages that you can take out of the case and screw into the hard drives. Now additionally, they come with these kind of plastic washers to reduce vibrations. Let's pop the 8TB hard drive into the bottom and two 4TB hard drives into the top. As a next step, I usually like to connect the PSU cables, because without having the motherboard installed yet, we still have a lot of space to work around. Now in fact, it would have been very smart to already connect the 8-pin CPU power cord into the motherboard at this stage already, as well as connecting all of the chassis fans. Turns out that when you put a motherboard into this specific case, then you don't have access to any fan or power pins on the upper side of the motherboard. Anyhow, I'll continue connecting the PSU with our hard drives and connect SATA cables to all of our drives. At this stage, I realized that I totally forgot to put the SSD into one of the cages, so I do that and connect the power and SATA connectors. And now it's time for the motherboard. First of all, we want to put the IO shield into the back and screw all of the standoffs required into the chassis. Next, let's gently drop the motherboard into the case and screw it in place. Connect the 24-pin ATX motherboard power plug to the motherboard, as well as USB and front panel connectors. Now this motherboard has a total of 8 SATA connectors, which is obviously very nice considering that I want to use this server as a backup as well as home cloud server. Now the grey and black plugs are obviously for 6 versus 3 gigabits per second of SATA speed. Now because we mainly connect hard drives, it doesn't really matter where I actually put them. Obviously I want to connect the SSD to the 6 gigabits per second connector, but in general with the hard drives it doesn't really matter where I put them. And finally I connected the 8-pin CPU power connector as well as all of the fans. Now as you can see, I should definitely have connected all of the cables to the upper part of the board before putting it into the case. Next we're gonna try and do some cable management. Now unfortunately in this case it's actually very difficult to do proper cable management because the kind of space that you're getting behind the motherboard is very small, it's about 1 centimeter, so you really have to put everything very tightly together and the outcome is probably less on the pretty side than it is on the practical one. Alright, and that is it. This is the finalized server build. Now the moment of truth, let's turn it on and see if everything properly works. I guess that is a yes. We can see Windows is booting up. Note, I actually had Windows installed on this specific SSD before for my previous streaming PC. So as you can see, everything is running nice and smoothly. The system recognizes 32 gigs of memory and the CPU is running at a nice 4 gigahertz as per the overclock that I set in BIOS. But that concludes the build of my first ever home server. In the next step, I'm going to have to set up Linux on this machine as well as set up a few web server slash home server specific tools. This is actually going to be the topic of my next video in this how to build a home server video tutorial series. So if you're interested in any of that, definitely subscribe for more. But thank you very much for watching. If you liked this video, leave a like. If you disliked it, leave a dislike. Thank you so much for watching. Have a wonderful day, and I'll see you guys in the next video.